Okay, our next speaker is Corey Stephenson from the University of Michigan at Ann Arbor. Corey started his independent career at, was it Boston College or University? Boston College, yeah? And then just recently has moved to the University of Michigan. He's had a huge impact in inorganic synthesis, really being one of the pioneers in bringing visible light mediated photochemistry and its impact on organic synthesis, and is probably one of the first in that field to really explore using photoinduced reactions in the seed functionalization arena. So we're delighted to have you join us, Corey. And the title of your talk is Visible Light Mediated CH Functionalization.
Thanks a lot, Hugh. It's really a pleasure and an honor to be part of this symposium and to share some of the work we've been doing first at BU and now most recently in Michigan. So on the next slide, it kind of gives you an idea of some of the things that we do. Most of the work, actually all of the work that we've done in this area stems from our interest in complex natural product synthesis. So much like Brian using natural products as an inspiration to develop chemical methods. Some of those are shown in the bottom left of this slide in terms of methodologies, whether they're related to making natural products or, as I'll tell you a little bit about today, a strategy towards making pharmaceuticals in collaboration with Eli Lilly. And then similar, again, lignin may come up three times, I can imagine, in this session. Is also an interest of ours to use the photo-induced electron transfer properties of these catalysts as a means to look at the depolymerizing lignin. So on the next slide, I just have a little more focused summary on some of the things we do. Again, natural product synthesis being the key point. And then the starting point for all the chemistry was an interest in looking at catalytic free radical chemistry. And then at the top, I'll talk more about the chemistry here. The CH functionalization typically initiated through amine oxidation chemistry. And then, although I won't speak to it today, I mean, the utility of these methods in terms of scale up then relies on technology. And in our case, we use a lot of continuous flow systems, very basic rudimentary things that we build ourselves, just because they're easy then to change up. So on the next slide, I'm going to make a case. I think a lot of folks that do this type of catalysis will make a case for why should we use visible light instead of UV light. And aside from just the expense, it's certainly easier to get a hold of photons from a visible light source. I think the key advantage of using visible light over high energy UV irradiation is the fact that we're exciting a catalyst which then transfers energy or electrons to a substrate, rather than giving the energy directly to the molecule itself to then rearrange or do with what it may. So there's certainly, I believe, a very important place for UV photochemistry. I don't want to say that I don't think this is an important area. There are certainly things at this point where you couldn't imagine that I couldn't imagine doing without that high energy light source. But today I'll just focus on the visible light photochemistry we've done in our lab. So I think on the next slide, I'm going to give a little bit of background. I think a lot of the folks in this session are probably not familiar with how these catalysts work and such. But the organic chemists like myself and Dave McMillan and Chen's colleague Teshik Yoon and others that have been working in this area really can stand on the shoulders of a lot of 30, 40 plus years of research in terms of the inorganic photochemistry, photophysics of complexes like ruthenium trispipyridine, whether that's in the area of solar cells, water splitting, or in the case of most of the iridium complexes, organic LED applications. So key to the chemistry here is that the excitation is with visible light, typically in the blue region of the spectrum. So this is at the high energy part of the visible light spectrum, but still outside of the range where most organic molecules are going to absorb the light. So in principle, this is where the selectivity then gets built in, and that the molecules we're interested in doing chemistry upon don't do anything productive or at all with the irradiation energy source that we're giving them. One of the other really nice things about the catalyst is that they can do multiple things depending on how you set up the reaction. In the top part of the cycle, if we have an electron source, in the reaction mixture, typically this is an amine. We're going to go through this pathway that gives rise to a very strongly reducing ruthenium 1 complex. That's what we've used for doing catalytic free radical chemistry. In contrast, if you have an electron sink like a peroxide or certain other metal complexes, you'll go through the bottom part of that cycle, the oxidative quenching cycle, to give rise to what would be this ruthenium 3 complex, which is a pretty strong single electron oxidant. So those two numbers are possibly not so meaningful to people who aren't typically thinking about one electron processes, but minus 1.3 volts, that's an acetonitrile, is something on the order of samarium iodide. You can think about chemistry along those lines. And 1.27 volts is maybe 100 or 200 millivolts weaker than something like ceric ammonium nitrate. So we might expect, using those kind of conditions, we can access that kind of oxidation or reduction potentials. So the next slide, I'll just give you a little bit more about the catalyst, I think. On the next slide, I think that's where the, so this is the nature of the excited state. The key point here is that after the initial excitation, there's a relaxation to the triple excited state, which is on the order of hundreds of nanoseconds to microseconds in the case of some of the iridium complexes. But the key point is that what we've done is a metal to ligand charge transfer, formally looking like we've oxidized on the metal, reduced or partially reduced one of the ligands. So the electron on the ligand, that's the one that's eventually going to be transferred to a substrate in a reduction, and the hole created on the metal, that would be filled by, say, the amine complex that we've had. So one of the other benefits, I think, of this kind of these kind of complexes is all the electron transfer is outer sphere, which means that the metal never coordinatively interacts with the substrates that we're interested in working with. So that can be a disadvantage based on some of the chemistry you can't do. But in terms of an advantage, it does cut down on one possible pathway for the catalyst to become deactivated via substrate or product inhibition of the catalyst. So next slide, please. So about a year and a half, 2 years ago, we actually put out a bunch of catalysts with Aldrich. These are all well-known complexes in the literature. We made them to start. So Aldrich has started selling these maybe 6 or 8 months ago. And then one of the main players in this talk, James Douglas, along with a former student, John Wen, put together a nice article in Aldrich Chemic Acta, which kind of outlines how one might choose a catalyst to go with a given reaction. So I think one of the things that's often lost in the methods that we've published, and perhaps other people's have published as well, but is where the rationale comes from choosing a catalyst outside of just simply screening. And typically there is a good reason to choose what you start with from the outset. Okay, next slide, please. So this just gives you an idea how we think about photoredox catalysis. Again, we think about breaking up the four parts of the cycle into quadrants. There are two oxidation steps in terms of the organic molecule that we're interested in making. That's in the top right and the bottom left. And two reduction cycles that we can think of. Again, that's in the top left and the bottom right. So the key point, I listed a bunch of advantages as we see them. I think the biggest advantage here is that there are multiple things that you can change in the reaction to gain control over the reactivity, whether that's the nature of the metal, the nature of the ligand, so in the complex you're starting with, or the additives that go into the reaction. So how those change will also impact the ultimate reactivity. So at the end of the day, we're accessing the chemistry of odd electron species. And again, these are the subsequent chemistry tends to be is something that is often known in the literature in the past. But the key is that we're accessing these reactive intermediates, and I think one of the slides coming up we'll see this, under really, really mild conditions. So at the outset, this is a slide I haven't used for some time, but just to introduce the thinking or where we started here, and this was this molecule on the left, actinophilic acid, a molecule that we still have some interest in trying to make, was really the starting point for all of the chemistry that has followed in terms of photocatalysis. And we were quite naive at the beginning. We had done a good amount of manganese 3 chemistry to do that reaction on the top. without the bromide, and came across some literature from Shinichi Fukuzumi reducing bromobenzophenone type materials, and thought this might give us access to the radicals we needed to use to do intermolecular coupling. So as Brian had shown in his talk, organic radicals will add to the C2 position of most heteroaromatics like indoles and related compounds based on the orbital properties of the heterocycle, and that is indeed what's seen. So one of the things that we naively thought initially was that the amine would just be a source of electrons and then would go away and wouldn't participate any further in the reaction. And then it really was the work of Joe Tucker and Jagannarayanan that really started and took this from what was initially a kind of a curiosity in our lab to something that became a full-blown program in photocatalysis. So the key point here was that the amine was not just innocent, it was also acting as a source of hydrogen atoms to prematurely quench the radicals that we were looking at. So on the next slide, I'll show you the initial solution to some of these problems, and the solution was pretty straightforward, and that was to make it cyclize, and therefore cutting down on some of the intermolecular hydrogen atom transfer. The yields here are not important, and the outcomes are not critically important, but these were the first meaningful yields, if you will, of carbon-carbon bond-forming reactions that we were seeing using the photocatalysis. So the most important experiment, I think, is on the next slide. And it was actually one that was pretty poor, one that you would often look at and say that's a bad result, given that we got 22% of our desired cyclization product. So Joe and Jagan were really diligent in tracking down all the other things that were present there. And I'll come back to this slide in a second as well. Two things that were important. One is the solution to the problem of premature hydrogen atom abstraction is to remove the hydrogen atoms beside the amine. But the other was an opportunity that we saw that by abstracting the hydrogen atom from the amine, we would generate an alpha amino radical, a species I'll talk about in a little bit more detail in a moment. Those are really easily oxidized radicals. Upon oxidation, that would give an aminium ion. And then in the course of reducing the radical from the malonate, we generate a malonate, which at our first thought, we were basically generating a nice reactive electrophile and a potential nucleophile in the same reaction. Could we then use these and couple that as a way to do a, well, formally what would be an oxidative version of a monic type of reaction. So on the next slide, I think I summarized just a couple of things that came of this, I'll get to the alpha amino radical chemistry first. So this is one of the things that I still find remarkable. This is by no means something that we discovered. This has been known for decades in the physical organic type of literature, but it's the dramatic impact that the loss of a single electron has on the bond strengths of all the CH and CC bonds adjacent to that nitrogen. So I think everyone would probably agree or come up with similar numbers for the pKa and possibly the bond association energy for the proton in blue being quite non-acidic and also having quite a reasonably strong bond strength. And at quite low oxidation potential, 0.73 volts, so this is something that most any photocatalyst that we have can do and also quite easily accessible. But taking a single electron from that molecule, probably changing the weight, not even at all, we change the pKa of that proton by 23 orders of magnitude, so down to the point where it's going to be deprotonated perhaps by triethylamine itself, and also precipitously drop the bond association energy. So the path that these molecules then tend to take is deprotonation to the alpha amino radical I mentioned before, and then subsequent oxidation, depending on the reaction, would lead to the aminium ions that we were most interested in looking at. So since two examples here I've just given as photocatalysis examples using alpha amino radicals, one from Dave McMillan's lab, coupling the alpha amino radical derived from N-phenyl pyrrolidine plus this cyanopyridine, and another example from Oliver Reiser's lab through a conjugate addition process to methyl vinyl ketone. Next slide, please. So we were looking similarly, these isoquinolines. I think if you follow or seen this literature, you'll see there are literally hundreds of examples of people oxidizing this substrate. It's a really easily oxidized substrate. In fact, if you just leave it out in the air, exposed to light, it will oxidize over time. What we did see is that we could do these in maybe 8 to 10 hours. Oxidation with an iridium photocatalyst in the presence of nitromethane, so nitromethane acting as our nucleophile, simply open to air would lead to 90 to 95% yield of the oxidative Aza-Henry product. So for a lot of reasons, we've kind of gone away from oxygen as our stoichiometric oxidant in principle because it tends to interfere with the photochemical properties of the catalyst. Bromotrichloromethane or perhaloalkanes are quite useful stoichiometric oxidants in the bottom part, which should be an anaerobic oxidation. Those then lead to the aluminium ions directly, and we can see these by NMR, and then in principle just drop in any nucleophile that we want, while we're still then limited a little bit in terms of the isoquinolones that we start with. But this was where we thought was an opportunity to look at some chemistry in collaboration with Eric Jacobson's group, which I think is on the next slide, where we might be able to, we thought we could couple anion binding catalysis that the Jacobson lab had been looking at with photocatalysis to do asymmetric additions to aluminium ions. And in principle, the initial idea was that whether we could actually have a thiourea photocatalyst as a complex that would then be able to be used to deliver whatever that X minus group might be into a variety of different species that we would generate, either via an atom transfer radical addition in the case of compound two, the oxidative generation of an oxocarbenium ion in three, or the aluminium ion chemistry that I'll tell you really briefly about here in a second. So on the next slide, you'll see some of the early experiments just looking to convince ourselves that the aluminium ions that we could generate actually did interact with these diarrhea catalysts that the Jacobson group was looking at. One of the key indicators that we saw were that the methylene protons highlighted in those blue boxes did start to show up as diastereotopic in the NMR of the complex. This then allowed us to do it not exactly as planned, so we do have to do a solvent switch here since the thiourea catalysts perform best in very nonpolar solvents and the photocatalysts perform much better in very polar solvents. Nonetheless, with a catalyst which has a benzothiophene in place of that phenyl group off the pyrrolidine, we were able to get up to almost to the point where we don't see the other enantiomer in that addition of the siloketine acetal. So one of the things that is notably absent when you look at people functionalizing these isoquinolones is that the aromatic group is never removed, and everyone, including us up until this point, would always indicate that the value of these compounds was actually in the free amine. You could then not go on to do chemistry, and it turns out it's just not that easy to remove. So we've developed some not particularly attractive conditions so far, but something that we can work to get better, which is iron bipyridine mediated oxidation, and I say mediated because that is four equivalents of iron in that reaction, since it is a four electron overall oxidation that's happening. So then we isolate just to confirm that we didn't lose any of the E in the end. So on the next slide, I think I'll move on to different modes. These are now, as we started to look a little bit more in terms of the practicality of some of this type of catalysis, this is started by a collaboration with Eli Lilly that was headed up by Dr. James Douglas, a postdoc in the group who's just about to transition to Lilly for the second stage of this collaboration. But this stemmed from some interest in trying to make the bond that's indicated in this molecule LY2784544 via the intermediacy of an alpha amino radical that would be generated using a photo catalyst. So on the next slide, we'll see a little bit more about what we were thinking, and I say a simplistic mechanistic rationale because one thing that became quite clear is there are a lot of potential options on how these chemistries are actually working. But upon excitation, the catalyst, these are reactions that I'll show you that are open to air, can reduce molecular oxygen to give an iridium 4 complex, which can oxidize one of these amines. And once that amine is oxidized, there's a weak base in the reaction which can deprotonate the on the methyl group to give this nucleophilic alpha amino radical. Coupling of that radical then with the heterocyclic core of the drug molecule leads then to a new radical which undergoes some oxidation and deprotonation, some rearmonization process to give the the molecule that would lead to this Lilly compound. So on the next slide, I think we see a little bit on how we actually control for these reactions. These are, I don't know, iteration 4 or 5 in terms of how we set up our photocatalytic reactions. So what we see is a jacketed beaker. This allows you to control very precisely the temperature of the reactions. And on the outside are very simple blue LED strips. Each strip, I think, looks like each reaction has probably about 3 strips surrounding it. Each strip costs around $9 or $10, and they're rated to last for 100,000 hours while consuming 1 watt of power. So under the optimized conditions that James had, he's down to half a mole percent of this iridium complex, a little bit of base for the reaction. And without any purification at the end, just by crystallization, the product actually will precipitate out of this DMA water mixture, so that we get 12-to-1 mixture of the exo versus the endo product, and then the isolated yield being 56% of the exo product. The endo product resulting from deprotonation of one of the methylene protons beside the nitrogen as well. So on the next slide, we get a little bit of a feel for the scope in terms of the amine. The scope in terms of the heterocycle is much less broad, but in terms of a strategy for introducing amines like this into to the heterocycles, we think this is quite a useful, perhaps late stage approach to introducing a variety of substrates. I think these ones are all then isolated by chromatography and not so much through this nice precipitation procedure. And then molecules or compounds that don't work, so a simple change from N-methyl to N-ethyl pyrrolidine, that reaction then is no longer working going forward. So on the next slide, I think we're gonna move forward, and then we'll come back to a slide that looks kind of similar. And this is this problem with the premature reduction of the radicals and how we can avoid it. And the simplest version that we thought of this was just to simply remove all the hydrogens on the carbons adjacent to our nitrogen. So on the next slide, I'll kind of look at the solution to that. And those were coming from aromatic amines. On the next slide, Dan. So these worked, and the substrate scope here, again, is not critically important, but these are now intermolecular couplings. Once this premature reduction pathway is removed, then the coupling reactions work quite nicely. The downside here is this amine is quite expensive, not for small-scale laboratory experiments, but for preparative experiments. And around this time when we started thinking about this is when James joined the lab, and we started thinking more about the practical aspects of this kind of catalysis. So, and the other reasons why this is quite wasteful, if you will, is the role of that amine is simply to give one electron and take one proton. So it's really playing a very minor role overall in the transformation. So I think on the next slide, we'll see the kind of analysis that we've undertaken, and then we'll look at some of the mechanistic results that we've seen where we do CH functionalization on the catalyst itself. So if we imagine a radical coupling with an indole, the process can be controlled, if you will, via a closed cycle where the initial radical is generated via reduction of the an alpha halo compound by the catalyst's excited state. The new benzylic radical then gives the electron back in a purely catalytic cycle, if that were the case, to the catalyst, and that would be a closed system. So what we really needed was a catalyst that could function directly to reduce the bromoethyl acetate in this case. And this is where this iridium trisphenylpyridine complex comes into play. It's a really excellent excited state reductant, minus 1.73 volts versus the saturated calomel electrode. Actually enables it to reduce things like simple alkyl vinyl and aryl iodides as well. So it's certainly perfectly capable of reducing bromoethyl acetate. So it was around this time that Jim Devery joined my lab and was interested in looking at a little bit more in terms of the mechanism of some of these transformations. What's the fate of the catalyst? How do things actually work? Can we actually take these 1 more percent of catalyst and drop it down by perhaps designing new complexes specifically for organic transformations? I'll just remind you that all the catalysts that we've used and most people are using today were designed for something completely different, whether that was an organic LED application, solar cells, or water splitting. So this is the direction that we chose to study. And Jim was a PhD student with Bob Flowers. So on the next slide, we'll see some of the experiments that we would run to kind of look at the mechanism. And the first one here is just a simple quenching experiment that just verifies that the bromoethyl acetate is indeed what is interacting with the catalyst. The quenching here is quite efficient. You can see the second order rate constant for quenching is also quite fast. So 10 to the fourth per molar, well, almost 10 to the fifth per molar per second. Given that the overall reaction is 12 hours, it seems unlikely that this would be the rate limiting aspect of the transformation. So on the next slide, we see the analysis that Jim had done. So this is a plot for using reaction progress kinetic analysis to look at the transformation, a process that Donna Blackman has certainly popularized among the organic chemists who want to look at mechanistic organic chemistry. One of the really nice things about this is, one, it's understandable to organic chemists like myself. It's also very easy to do, and it also looks at the reactions under catalytically relevant conditions. So these are the conditions that we would normally run the reactions in. That's the ones we're looking at the transformations. So the curve in red is just a normal transformation. We see the decay where we consume the 3-methyl indole. The curve in blue is the one that started in which is labeled run 2, and it starts as if we had consumed half of the material that we start with. So at run 2, it's the equivalent of what we would expect to be in the flask at 50% conversion. At that point, we've consumed half of our indole, an equivalent amount of ethyl bromoacetate, and an equivalent amount of base, but the amount of excess of each reagent remains the same. So in the event where there's no difference in the reaction, where the catalyst is still capable and still perfectly intact, we would expect that the blue line should completely overlap with the red line. And what you see is something completely different, where the blue line is much faster. So the blue curve is consuming the 3-methyl indole at a much faster rate than in the red line, indicating that in the red reaction in run one, not all the catalyst is actually capable of initiating the transformation at that point. So at this point, there's several options in terms of what could happen to the catalyst. A lot of those have been looked at by a lot of people before, and how catalysts can then degrade. Because of the fact that these iridium complexes are coordinately saturated, a lot of those options actually kind of go away. So on the next slide, we can see some of the more detailed aspects of this when looking at these even under how quickly the catalyst is degraded. We identified the first byproduct where the catalyst is degraded is this monoalkylation product on the phenyl ring of the phenylpyridine rings. Within about 15 minutes, almost all of the iridium trisphenylpyridine catalyst that we start with has been consumed. And you see that a lot of these then either initially the shoulder and then followed by several new products to the point where within 15 to 30 minutes, the original catalyst is no longer actually even present in the reaction mixture. Okay, next slide, please. Oh, next slide, please, Dan. Oh, yeah. So, and then we do the reaction here in the and look at it by mass spectrometry. What we see is we can see up to five additions of ethyl acetate, the radical derived from bromoethyl acetate, to the catalyst, plus their N+23, the N plus sodium peak. So the initial monoalkylated catalyst, the assumption here, although we haven't structurally characterized the following four, is that the reactions initially go on all the benzene rings of the phenylpyridine complexes, followed presumably by alkylation on the pyridine rings. Again, those haven't been structurally characterized. At which point the catalyst is no longer capable of initiating the transformation is unclear at this point. So next slide, Dan. So what we did see, and I think the most important thing, is that the catalyst is deactivating as the reaction proceeds. Jim was able to characterize the reaction kinetically, that it's first order in all the components that you might expect, and positive order in catalyst. I think the order was 0.8. There was a primary kinetic isotope effect that suggests reionization is rate limiting. But the key was this would be the point where we can perhaps design new catalysts that would avoid this deactivation and allow us to get to a goal which would perhaps be 1% of 1% in terms of catalyst loading. So just, I think, a couple slides that are left to show you where we have gone here. I think our initial ideas were that we could develop a completely bulletproof catalyst that wouldn't undergo deactivation. This slide just shows you that the monoethylated catalyst actually is active. It is slower than the starting catalyst that we might expect. So the next slide, I think, shows the places where we started to think about modifying the complex. This is just a selection of those that we've made. On the next slide, we'll see the data for this monomethylated catalyst on the left, the far left. So qualitatively, we see here is the difference between the 50% run and the 100% run is there's not as big of a difference between the monoalkylated catalyst and when it's been run in the 50% version. So again, qualitatively, it looks like it's better. This is at 0.375 mole percent, which was optimal. Next slide, please. And then what this has led to, so we haven't been able to avoid deactivation completely, but just by some simple design changes, we're able to at least take the catalyst at 0.375 mole percent, drop the catalyst loading by 50% to 0.187 mole percent, and get the equivalent reactivity in terms of the conversion and reaction time. So it turns out that this is quite a common effect for these catalysts, and I guess perhaps not surprising in that they were not designed to be in solution with organic free radicals as we go forward. So certainly an ongoing pursuit for us to come up with new strategies to develop the catalyst that will be perhaps more stable and allow us to get to these 10% or 1% of 1% for these precious metal complexes. Okay, so I think the next slide is the last one, just to thank some of the folks in the lab. So the two people that I think featured most prominently here are in the back of the slide right next to me. James Douglas, the guy without the hat, is the postdoc who's part of this Lilly collaboration, and Jim Devery with the hat, with the Michigan hat, is about to leave the group and go join the faculty at Loyola University in Chicago in the next month or so. So certainly indebted to those guys for their work. Kevin Cole, who I didn't mention, is our collaborator at Lilly, who's been very interested in pushing this kind of catalysis in the process setting. So that's where I'll leave it. Hopefully I didn't go too far over